G'day, my smart mates. My name's Dylan Dance. I'm a physicist from the land down under. Grab a coffee, grab a chair, grab a Vegemite sandwich. Look, grab whatever you want to grab. Let's talk some natural philosophy. So we're finally watching some more Rick and Morty today, and I'm going to check out this Pickle Rick thing. Whatever that means. We're going to see if we can find some physics and science that can explain Pickle Rick. So, but before we do, make sure you subscribe and like this video. And leave a comment down under if you have any good suggestions for things that I can react to and find some physics in.
Morty!
Rick?
Hey, Morty!
Rick? Are you far away or are you inside something? Is this a camera? Is everything a camera?
Morty! The garage, Morty! Come to the garage! Morty!
Rick? Where are you?
On my workbench, Morty.
Are you invisible and you're gonna, like, fart on me?
Flip the pickle over.
What? I'm
pickle, Morty. You're not gonna regret it. The payoff is huge. I turned myself into a pickle, Morty! Boom! Big reveal. I'm a pickle. What do you think about that? I turned myself into a pickle! What are you just staring at me for, bro? I turned myself into a pickle, Morty.
And?
And? What more do you want tacked on? I'm a pickle! I'm Pickle Rick!
Yeah, his face says it all. Look, I've got nothing for you guys. I don't know where to begin with this one. Not sure physics can help us here. This is beyond anything I've ever come across in physics. So I think we're just going to have to move on and see what else we can find. I honestly just thought Rick was going to have some obsession with eating pickles or some pickle fetish, but clearly I'm lacking imagination. So I'm intrigued to see what this pickle can do, so let's keep watching.
We got them.
Because this pickle doesn't care about your children. And I'm not gonna take their dreams. I'm gonna take their parents.
That's one intense laser. Double A batteries. Come on. All right, so we could probably work out the energy in one of those AA alkaline batteries for it to produce that sort of laser. And we could work out the brightness of that beam of radiation, so the monochromatic specific intensity. So let's do some calculations. Alright, let's run through these calculations because you probably can't read much, but you've got a nice little picture here. You've got Rick's godlike laser and three heads ready to be melted. And then you can work out the change in temperature of the heads because obviously they're at room temperature before they're melted. And then if you look up at what temperature humans are cremated at, so I looked up what temperature humans are cremated at, and it's about 593 Kelvin, apparently. I just re-looked that up and it's way off, but look, this will still demonstrate the point I'm trying to make, all right? So then you've got the specific heat capacity of a bone. You've got the average weight of a male human head, unless your head is 4.5 standard deviations larger than the average human head. And then that gives you this number here, 892,936 joules. That's just for one head. Then you work it out for three heads. You get about 2.67 megajoules. Now, the average AA battery will give you about 13,000 joules. Somehow Rick's battery that he found produces 2.67 million joules. So yeah, that's one pretty ridiculous battery. But anyway, this next bit shows you just how ridiculous the laser is. So not gonna go through this bit because it's a bit more involved. There's some integration involved, but it works out the monochromatic specific intensity of Rick's laser gives you this number down here, which is 5 times 10 to the 26 times greater than the brightness of the sun, which is a trillion, more than a trillion trillion times greater than the brightness of the sun. So yeah, that's a pretty intense laser he's managed to whip together in about 2 seconds. So yeah, I reckon that's enough physics for this video. So anyway, let's watch some more.
Oh, great.
Oh, boy. What's wrong, Rick? Is it the quantum carburetor or something?
Quantum carburetor? Jesus, Morty, you can't just add a sci-fi word to a car word and hope it means something. Huh. Looks like something's wrong with the microverse battery. We're gonna have to go inside.
Pause it there. That's exactly what the show does all the time. But anyway, I just wanted to say quantum isn't a sci-fi word. It's a real word that and it represents real things in nature. So a quantum is the smallest possible amount of a physical entity of an interaction. So when you have more than one quantum, we call them quanta. And a really important thing to note here is that these quanta can only come in discrete packets. So what I mean by that is that nature isn't continuous. So let me use an analogy to try and explain this because it might help you understand. So you've got two pieces of chalk here, right? One small one, one big one. And you could imagine a piece of chalk any size in between these two, couldn't you? It's a continuous thing. You don't need to only have, you know, one this big and one this big. But in nature, on the smallest possible scale, for any physical entity, if this was the smallest amount of energy it was allowed to have for a physical entity, and then this was the next amount of energy it was allowed to have, you can't have anything in between. That's what I'm trying to say. So for any physical entity, there's only allowable amounts of energy it can have. You can't have anything in between. And that goes for everything in nature. It's really friggin' weird. All right, that's enough of that. You guys can look further into that if you want. When I paused, he was talking about some microverse battery and how they were going to have to go inside. So I'm interested to hear what the hell he's talking about. So I'll rewind just a little bit.
Oh man, where are we, Rick?
Morty, remember 8 seconds ago when you said go inside what? And I said the battery, and then we showed up here and I wasn't like, whoa, this is unexpected. Huh, this isn't right. This pipe's supposed to be sending 20 terawatts of juice up to the engine, Morty. Instead, we've got zero? Now what are these people doing?
Whoa, people?
It's time for some hands-on engine repair. I put a spatially tessellated void inside a modified temporal field until a planet developed intelligent life. I then introduced that life to the wonders of electricity, which they now generate on a global scale. And, you know, some of it goes to power my engine and charge my phone and stuff.
Appears we are being revisited by the alien known as Rick, who once gave our world the gift of Googlebox technology, which, when stomped on, generates electricity, powering our homes and businesses, improving our daily lives, while safely removing the dangerous waste power to a special disposal volcano. But why has Rick returned? And what will he say when he hears the big news? Let's find...
So Rick said his ship gets about 20 terawatts of power. And tera is a trillion, so that's 20 trillion watts. So we can work out how many people must be in this little microverse. That's how much power he gets. So on average, a human can generate about 75 watts over 8 hours. So if you assume half of that is waste, so you get about 37.5. So power is equal to energy over time. So if you take the 20 trillion watts, divide that by 37.5, you're going to get a number. So let me quickly calculate that. So that works out to be 533 billion people working 24 hours a day. So obviously, people need to sleep. So if you assume, you know, they work a third of the day, you multiply that by 3 and you get about 1.6 trillion people working 8 hours a day on these Google boxes. So yeah, that's a lot of people. 1.6 trillion people, that's 200 times larger than the population of Earth. And for reference, Earth, our civilization's current power consumption is about, I think it's about 18 terawatts a year. So Rick's little ship generates more power than all of humanity's consumption every year. So someone pointed out that we actually missed some physics in that first episode we watched of Rick and Time, when Rick's trying to prove that they're both pieces of poo. So let's go back, watch it, and I'll see what I can see.
Conclusion: you're both equally mercurial, overly sensitive, clingy, hysterical bird brain homunculus.
Alright, so on this board, let's have a look. I can see in the top left corner psi, which represents the wave function in quantum mechanics. So the wave function, quantum state, eigenfunction, it's all the same sort of thing. So, and that is for the infinite square well, which is like a common problem in quantum mechanics, 101. So in the middle there, I could barely make out what it says. That's more math than physics, but it says summer is isomorphic to Morty if and only if there exists a mapping such that for all summers there exists exactly one Morty. So I think that's what it says. And isomorphic essentially means that two sets are equivalent. So Rick, using real abstract algebra, essentially proved that they're both equally pains in his ass. So that's pretty great. There is a problem with what he's written, but it's a little nitpick, so we'll ignore that. So then down the middle there, that is a cat. Presumably Schrodinger's cat. That's both alive and dead at the same time. And then the bottom right, you've actually got a differential equation, which is Schrodinger's equation, which is one of the most famous in all of physics. We essentially use it to calculate the probability that we'll find an electron in any given position in terms of its orbit. But it's not really orbiting. Electrons don't really orbit atoms. They exist in this, what we call a probability cloud around an atom. So the electron in its probability cloud, it's kind of existing everywhere simultaneously around the atom. And then when you take measurement, you collapse this wave function. When you measure where an electron is, you collapse this superposition of the electron being everywhere around the atom at once, and then it exists in one place. But anyway, if I lost you, you can go do some further reading on that. It's a really fascinating thing in physics. Anyway, that'll do for this video. I'll finish with a nice quote from Brian Cox, a famous particle physicist, and I think it relates to this show. And he says, "In science, there are no universal truths, just views of the world that have yet to be proven false." So anyway, I'll leave it there, guys. Please subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll catch you guys next time.